Level interventions and to scale these innovations, you definitely need the public sector and the government, the enabling environment and the regulatory framework. So yes, innovations come from the private sector, but the scale has to be enabled by the public sector, and without scale in Asia, we are basically lost. What you can't scale, you should forget. I think that's a very important
message.
So Susan,
are you saying that the private sector should not run healthcare?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying there is a role for the private sector, and we should look at the private sector as a partner with government, but there has to be a very holistic framework on where the private sector can add value. There needs to be a discussion with the public sector. I want to pose that question to you. Do you think that the private sector can provide health services to poor people in remote areas? Probably, I see your faces, probably no, right? Because there is no business model, there's no advantage, there won't be any competition for the private sector. Can the private sector provide healthcare in urban areas, primary, secondary? Yes. Can they do specialized care? Yes, obviously. I think there's lots of debate if it's really true that the private sector is always more efficient and always provides better quality. We know now the answer is probably not clear, probably not, right? It has to be really the right solution for the right problem, and that's why we need the dialogue.
I agree with Susan. I think the issues are so widespread and grassroots. I think there needs to be a partnership between public sector and private sector. I think there needs to be a skin in the game for both the parties or both the stakeholders. I think more than ever before, the possibility to do disease awareness and to educate patients, consumers is today. 66% of the world's population is connected through mobile. In Southeast Asia, about 50% are connected to broadband. So I think we need to leverage the infrastructure that's been created. I think there is an issue around literacy, around education, if you really want a widespread solution. So while we can think of many other ways to educate people, I think we also need to solve the issue around that. And that is again, needs to be in partnership with the public sector. Because education is not something that only private sector can do it at a scale that needs to be quite dramatic, because most of it will need to be socialized and needs to be supported. Another thing we need to take care of, I mean, we talk about, you know, in spite of having disease awareness, the reason to prevent a lot of illnesses is by living well, have the right diet, have the right lifestyle. But it's easier said than done. To change a behavior of an individual needs a lot of effort. You need, one way to do it could be having regulations. So smoking ban, if you really see, in Philippines, it was recently announced there'll be no smoking in public places. That was top down, whether you agree the way it was done or not. But that is one way of actually imposing a regulation that will force you to change your behavior. That could be one way of doing things. Other way of doing things could be constantly educating the people, which will take time. It's a more longer term solution, but it's a way of getting people behind it. So I think we'll need to think about various things, and all of it will need to happen together. We can't wait for a sequential approach.
There's now the growing body of work on something called social entrepreneurship, which is a different and innovative way of providing healthcare, which draws from multiple income streams, which seeks to build a sustainable model to deliver care using, you know, commercial business models. So, for example, there's e-healthcare point, for example, from India, which sells subscriptions to water supply to rural communities, but also sites health clinics, primary health clinics, and telehealth clinics at the same point, using the money from the water subscriptions to pay for that. There's a really excellent article, in case you think Singaporeans aren't involved in this work, by two professors from National University of Singapore and a very prestigious JAMA, which is the General American Medical Association, written by Prof. Lim Yue, who, for full disclosure, is my brother, and Prof. Audrey Chow from the School of Business Health, Business School. So I think if we have to move away from all these traditional models, and when we have innovative models, we can deliver much, much better and much more care to more rural community.
There has to be a partnership between private and public. I think we agree on that. Where I will push back is the question of scale. I think, we are moving to a world where, you know, the typical way of atoms moving to bits, right? So the typical way of going to your hospitals to take healthcare may not be there in 5 or 10 years' time. Okay. Given all the development that's happening on artificial intelligence, deep machine learning, you know, your medicine getting delivered through drone and stuff like that, right? So, and with everyone carrying a mobile phone, which is as powerful as the, you know, first Apollo that went to Mars. So the question is that I don't think a scale, for scale we need public sector. I think where we need public sector is more on the overall policy and guideline on, or sort of the, you know, drawing the boundaries within which the private sector needs to operate so that the profit motive of private sector doesn't go and impact the society in a negative way. That's where I think the public sector, public policy needs to come in. But the question of scale coming from public sector, I don't think it will be a valid argument in 5 to 10 years.
But let's look at the realities. I mean, Bangladesh, you have good coverage, but look at the Philippines or look at Indonesia, where the private sector, if you look at telecommunication companies, is interested in high populous areas and urban areas. You still, you know, you still have huge coverage and network issues in areas where the private sector is not interested in. So you will need public sector backbone ICT infrastructure investments to be able to scale the business models you wish to see. I think that also has to be very clear. We cannot rely on the private sector goodwill.
Now, but the point I'll say that the areas which are not covered by mobile, yeah. I mean, you know, there are, you know, like from Belun, there are many other initiatives now going on,
yeah.
Which will bring all these areas under mobile coverage.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We need to take a question because, yeah. As you know, they can keep going. Can I take a question from the lady first?
My name is Nani Eliana. I'm from Bridges MNC, a medical and healthcare public relations company. One of the big trends that we've been noticing in many of the ASEAN countries is that many of the young doctors, when I say young, I'm talking about 25, 30, who just graduated from medical school, are moving away from the primary healthcare and moving on to private practice and doing aesthetics medicine. So is there a way for us to incentivize them to remain in primary healthcare? Is there a need for us to do that?
How about we take the second question together?
Ken Nixon's my name. I'm a sustainability consultant. I think the healthcare sector access to medicine could really be facilitated if there was that social enterprise approach, which works in many sectors, and there's no reason why it can't work in this sector. So it takes collaboration, maybe going beyond partnerships to be a very trusting, collaborative approach where you're able to bring the best together. And I know there's always a bit of a problem in the pharmaceutical industry because there's the ethical question, there's the regulation question, and you've got to sort of toe the line, if you like, to make sure you don't overstep the mark in terms of having more influence than you should. So, but there really is a need for that trusted, collaborative approach in the Medicare sector.
Okay, let's take Ken's question first. Ramu, would you like to, you know, talk about?
Yeah, I think we need to understand that the access issues mean differently to different countries. So, for example, in China, the bigger issue is we all say people kind of gravitate towards urban cities because that's where reputable doctors are functioning. The issue is not that. The issue is between 2009 and 2011, China made an effort to invest $7 billion in village clinics, in county hospitals, in community healthcare centers. And they created all this infrastructure, but nobody trusts in the physicians going to that infrastructure. So that's why they go to bigger cities like Beijing or Shanghai. So there the issue is, how do you ensure that the healthcare practitioners that are in China are incentivized to go and practice in those communities or villages or local provinces?
Okay, and I have to stop you there, so we'll continue after the break. Please stay with us on Perspectives.